who cannot access base hospitals for various reasons. Earlier, more than a couple of decades back, the only mode of outreach was by way of surgical camps in sub-optimal facilities. This gave it to model of screening camps in the community and surgeries in base hospitals. Since then, primary eye care centers called vision centers have come into being. This also is a good sizable fundable unit for funding NGOs. This combination, unintentionally though, introduced and added vision centers in most organizations quickly, organically, rather than systematically. The primary requirement in establishing and running vision centers effectively will depend a lot on the leadership of hospitals views them as part of the hospital ecosystem, an extended OPD, which happens to be offsite and not as a standalone independent facility outside the system. Since it is an OPD, it must follow the same protocol as the hospital in comprehensive eye examination of all patients. It should be backed by clinical diagnosis by an ophthalmologist from the base hospital by our teleconsultancy. Prescription of medicine, glasses, and referral advice needs to come from the doctor for legal compliance. Similarly, there needs to be an administrative support system for the vision centers linked to the hospital with regular, frequent on-site visits to deal with logistics, cash handling, equipment maintenance, and other issues which will crop up while working alone in the community. This will also help to integrate the vision center allied ophthalmic personnel to feel as part of the same ecosystem as the base hospital. As vision center ophthalmic personnel are offsite and have to do a lot of functions other than the normal OPD personnel, their training needs to be in the curriculum in of what is required in hospital OPD, plus an extra curriculum to equip them with additional skills which are needed. Grooming persons from the same or nearby localities of vision centers where they'll be posted should be the norm. Stringing all this together would essentially require a common IT platform analogous to the base hospital, so that they all have the same screen, same database to access the patient. Most of you have some of these elements already in place. However, based on our exposure to vision centers across the subcontinent, our observations are all of us could benefit by going through systematically checking what systems are in place, invigorating the systems which are already in place to function appropriately, instilling missing systems or components for the benefit of the community you all serve, as well as your institutions. This will help in structuring vision centers whose ownership is predominantly with hospitals, unlike the eye camps where the ownership was or should be predominantly with the community. Aravind also will benefit while doing this exercise with you all, making it a win-win situation. As already said in the listing, the foremost requirement is the leadership mindset. Perception, conception, and prioritization of vision centers as integral part of hospital ecosystem in a hub and spoke model. This will drive the other points which are listed, which are predominantly operationalizing such a commitment by the leadership and the institution. I hope and pray after undergoing this program, all of you would be able to provide primary care in a hybrid mode. Eye camps where necessary, it will be events, and vision center as an ongoing program in community. My best wishes. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for the great overview and bringing everyone on board for the presentations to follow. Followed by this, I kindly request Mr. R.D. Tulsiraj, the Executive Director of LICO, to talk on the importance of primary eye care and how a vision center can be a viable way of achieving universal coverage. So over to Tulsiraj, sir. This is the problem with it.
Everyone is an elusive goal that many of us are aspiring, right from the World Health Organization to national governments to individual institutions. And then as we looked into this of ways of achieving it, the primary eye care approach, or what we commonly call as vision centers, seem to be offering a hope. In the past, and even today, eye cams are the essential means for reaching those who have challenges in accessing, or the group that is really left out from eye care. And several organizations do a large number of eye cams, including in Aravind. Last year, we did more than 3,000 outreach activities, screening over 530,000 people, resulting in close to 100,000 cataract surgeries, of which 88,000 odd were cataracts. 100,000 was all surgeries put together. While these numbers are quite impressive, a study done about 20 years ago showed that we reached only 7% of those who felt a need for eye care. That is, we went back to the villages where eye camps were held, did a house-to-house search to list people who felt that they had an eye problem, and then we matched those people with those who actually attended the eye camp, and that was a dismal 7%. And in these camps, patients with more advanced conditions are not able to be addressed for multiple reasons, including the technology that we're able to take to outreach. So in hindsight, there was a lot of clarity as to why this uptake was so low, because these eye camps tended to be one-off. So we normally conducted once a year, or at best once every quarter or so. While eye care needs are there in the community constantly, so it requires something to be available there on an ongoing basis. So this presentation is going to be talking about a particular solution that we arrived at Aravind Eye Hospital. And for any solution to be effective, it is always good to start with some key guidelines or a framework. So this is what we started with. One, we recognize that if the goal is to provide eye care to everyone, we need to have a very strong denominator or a community focus so as to ensure eye care to everyone. And the center must provide comprehensive and quality eye examination, even though this is going to be at a remote area. And then the design of this center should take into account the notion of closing the care loop. That is, starting with diagnosis to prescription to making sure that the patient is actually able to access the intervention that has been advised. Because only this approach of closing the loop really betters the patient's eye condition and resolves the issue. And equally, we also will need to manage these centers remotely. Because this the scale wouldn't allow to put in its own managers and that cadre of people. So all that is required to run this center efficiently has to be done remotely. And all of this has to be scalable, because the Shin centers by design would cater to a small population. So just doing one or two vision centers are not going to be adequate. It has to cover the entire population eventually. So we started off with the rule of thumb estimation of what is the denominator or eye care needs in the community. Vision centers typically have a reach of about 7 to 10 kilometers radius, which in the context of India would be a 50,000 population. So in this 50,000 population, a very rough or a conservative estimate is that roughly 1/4 or 25% of the population would have some form of eye care need. Some of it could be addressed, some of it would not, most of it in our context would not have been addressed. If you assume a cataract surgical rate of 10,000 as the need to get rid of cataract as a cause of blindness, then this would translate to 500 surgeries to be done annually in this 50,000 population. By a similar logic, if you assume 20% of the population would benefit from wearing a pair of glasses, which let us say again very, very conservatively that they may want to change in 4 or 5 years, would translate to providing 2,000 glasses annually for a population of 50,000, since glasses break and the powers also do change. And there are conditions which require ongoing care, like glaucoma, which many studies have established affects 1% of the population, which would be roughly 500 for a population of 50,000. And similarly, in India, the estimate is roughly 3% of the population has diabetes, which would mean about 1,500 people. And then people with incurable blindness or low vision are likely to be another 100 people. So this is the eye care needs in the community of, say, 50,000 people. And this is what the design and the aspiration of the vision center should be to address, in case we want towards the goal of achieving universal eye health. So these are some impact figures. In Aravind, we have 79 vision centers. The first center was put up in 2004, and some of the last centers happened in during the last 12 months. They cover a population of roughly 7 million, and of that, we have uniquely seen about close to 2.8 million people are registered with the vision centers. These are unique patients. Not visit. Many of them would have come several times. So what this is telling us is 2.8 million out of 6.9 million people have registered, which gives overall average coverage of about 40% of the population. And over the years, we have delivered over 600,000 glasses and performed over 150,000 cataract surgery. If you take year specific year, that is the last year, these centers together saw close to 700,000 patients, over 100,000 glasses were prescribed, and 91% of them actually bought the glasses. This is important to monitor and note. That's about 92,000 odd glasses. And of those advised cataract surgeries, about 24,000 got operated. And then there were cases which had to be referred to the base hospital, and they were close to 50,000, and of them 67% or 2/3 of them actually visited the hospital and got whatever advice for their eye condition. So we also realized that vision centers are potential enablers of tertiary care in terms of making it effective, because a lot of the work in tertiary care tends to be chronic in nature, like this around managing glaucoma, diabetic retinopathy, or corneal grafts, and so on, all of which require long or longer term follow-up. And for many of these conditions, you know, regular follow-up and the regular intervention, change of medication is essential to ensure good outcomes and to preserve their vision. So we recognize that vision centers with a reachable population within its service area are much better placed to ensure their compliance and better outcome. So let me run through an example quickly. This is about Thane Hospital, which should be somewhat similar to many of the secondary hospitals in the country. This was established in 1985 and now has a service area population of 1.2 million. It essentially covers the district of Thane. Apart from this base hospital, it also has seven vision centers that is completely run and staffed and run and managed by this hospital. So last year, the base hospital saw 127,000 patients, outpatient visits, while the vision centers handled another 70,000 visits. While the base hospital was able to sell about 22,000 spectacles, the vision centers sold about 10,000. Of the total cataract surgeries done of about 8,500, roughly 27% or 2,250 were done through the vision centers. And if you look at an average output of a vision center, it is close to 10,000 visits per annum or roughly 30 patients seen per day, 1,370 spectacles dispensed, and 320 cataract surgeries. And then this is probably a critical insight, especially when it comes to scaling. With appropriate services, pricing, etc., where in the vision centers we charge 20 rupees for consultation, which is good for three visits, and there's also income from sale of medicines and glasses. While there's an income, it also reduces the cost of to the patient, you know, by eliminating the cost of getting these things. So when we look at the income and expenditure of running the vision center, it tends to be cost neutral. You know, the cost is pretty much fully recovered. And then in addition, because we now don't have to do outreach, you know, for finding these patients, and then outreach does cost money, and in our context, the cost of case finding is 360 rupees per surgical case that is done, and that's completely avoided for those cases referred from the vision center. So because the patient comes on their own to the vision center, also on their own to the base office. And if you factor that cost saving, it is on the overall roughly around 800,000 rupees or a little more than 100,000 rupees per vision center. Of those patients referred from the vision center, 940, which is a significant proportion, close to 40%, prefer to get the surgery done in the paying side. So even if you very conservatively assume a margin of 3,500 rupees per paying surgery, this resulted in an additional net income of more than 3.3 million rupees. So you can recognize that financially it is a win, which means that as you scale and put in more vision centers, it is not going to put a financial stress on the system. So what makes all this happen? I think if we go down to the root cause, it essentially is the leadership. No, the leadership should really want to provide eye care to everyone in the community. That's fundamental for a good setup of a mission center. The leadership should make the primary eye care integral to their eye care delivery strategies or and not as something on the side. And then the design must be proactive in completing the loop. You know, referral, tracking referral, making sure medicines that are available locally, and so on. And then it also requires challenging the hospital team to kind of adopt the denominator mindset so that universal eye care can be realized. You know? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the very, very comprehensive presentation covering the Vision Center's contribution to universal eye health, its financial viability, and also its scalability and the commitment of leadership and all. This is a very resourceful presentation. And as a follow-up, we request Dr. Deepankar Datta, the Chief Medical Officer of Aravind Eye Hospital, Theni, about which Tulsiraj sir has just now spoken about also in his example. We request Dr. Datta sir to tell us about how vision centers can be helpful for secondary eye hospitals and what are the challenges that he had to overcome in order to make it successful. In the meantime, we request the participants. If you have any questions, please type in the chat box. So over to Dr. Datta sir.
Thank you, Laiko, for giving me this opportunity to share my experiences with the Vision Center. Actually, the Vision Center experiment for Aravind Eye Care system started in Aravind Hospital Theni long back in 2004. And now we have crossed around 15 to 16 years of our existence. And we have gone from one center to seven centers. So I'll share some of my experiences, what I have gained over the years of running Vision Center. And I hope it will be useful for those who are aspiring to start a vision center or have some doubt as to what does it do or what benefit it will be for the people in the villages or anywhere wherever we set up the center. Let's see what I have actually done in the last year. I'm just sharing 1 year data. The last year, we have seen 252,000 outpatients. And if you look at the slide, 50% patients have come to the hospital. 28% patients have been seen in the vision center. And community center and camp, okay, this is the number. The importance, the meaning of this is that 28% patients without coming to the center hospital have got some benefit and service from us through the Vision Center. And I strongly believe this number is only because the presence of the Vision Center. How I'll show you on the next slide. Now see the interpretation of that particular result is that we have increased our capacity without increasing the permanent infrastructure. Hospitals are permanent infrastructure. If you see whatever number you see, if you see less also, the infrastructure remains same. You can't increase the infrastructure because all of a sudden you have more patient and you cannot decrease the infrastructure if you don't have that number of patient. But then without increasing infrastructure, and which is permanent, the Vision Center is a very good viable option. How it helps is that it helps in reducing overcrowding in the hospital, thereby increases the comfort of the patient. It increases accessibility to the services. Now, when the patients see that the hospital is not overcrowded, they don't have to wait for too long. Doctors are able to attend to them within a short time. Sisters are able to do all the examination comfortably. The more number of footfalls actually happens in the hospital. This is an indirect benefit of starting the Vision Center, where you can see more number of patients who really does not need a long duration in the hospital. They have got a small ailments which can be really taken care in the Vision Center level. Another number three is that the Vision Center, we have one or two ophthalmologists giving consultation for that number of patients which we have seen in the Vision Centers. As against, we have got 15 ophthalmologists. So what happens is that you have got the maximum utilization of the manpower at the reduced cost. There's another advantage. Number four is that you have the flexibility of shifting or relocating or merging some center in case there is inadequate uptake. A particular center is not doing very well, we analyze, and if we feel that relocating it or merging with two more center will give more or will increase the footfall, you can do with the Vision Centers, because the Vision Centers are all rented buildings. These are all not our own building. We have not spent money on building up that infrastructure. Number five will be the cost saving, as these are established with the involvement of the local philanthropists community. Obviously, because the local people comes to establish this or help us in establishing this, the rent is usually low and a sense of ownership by the community develops. It becomes their center. And if you look at the number six, the staff from local community, normally our Vision Center are staffed by MLOPs or the sisters or staff from the local community who are actually residing there. So they have got a better familiarity with the staff, naturally better acceptance of services. It gives a psychological comfort. Our girl is there manning the center. Our girl is running the center. It is our center. That sort of psychological comfort. This is equivalent to, whenever you go to any hospital, you see a doctor, next time you go for follow-up and you see, okay, he is my doctor. That psychological comfort you get. The same thing happens when you have the staff from the same community manning the center. It also reduces the travel time and cost for the patient, and it's a saving, both time-wise and money-wise. Another advantage is that it gives the freedom from dependence. An old lady, nobody to take them to the hospital, which is 30, 40, 50 kilometer. The Vision Center is maybe 10 kilometer, 5 kilometer. My neighbor is going. After lunch, let us go and have a checkup. So that freedom from independence happens in the Vision Center because of its locality, within the community it is. Obviously, Vision Centers wean away the patients from the over-the-count drug use and harmful traditional practices. Even if we have camps, we go at the weekends. Whereas diseases can happen any point of time. So, normally, if somebody is having any disease which needs immediate attention, they immediately either need to go to the hospital, which may be far away, or the easy way is to go to the pharmacy and buy some drugs, or go to a traditional practitioner. Now, because of the presence of Vision Center, 6 days a week, from morning 9 to 5, and it's low cost, the people can straightway go to the center and get treated. And this is a very strong teaching tool for the base hospital, if it is a teaching center. Because here we are not seeing the patient really, but we are seeing the patient virtually. We are getting all the information. So going through the history, going through the records, coming to a diagnosis, and it actually strengthens the teaching faculty, the thought process of the doctor who is treating the patient. Next one. So, but then challenges are many actually. One you can think of is the infrastructure or the location. Where should I locate it? We have learned our lessons over the last 14, 15, 16 years. And it has to be in a place which is accessible to multiple villages. We have actually have seen one particular center, the first center of ours, was not running very well. So we had to relocate and merge with another center to make it viable by the number of footfalls, not money wise. So this is one. Second thing is that the connectivity. Right from the beginning, our motto was to all the patients who are coming to the center should get a consultation with the doctor. In 2004-05, imagine there was no cell phone penetration into the villages. So how do you connect? So we had experimented with many things. Ultimately, we landed up by, you know, modifying the Wi-Fi to go a long distance. And this was done by a group of students from University of California. And they did a PhD on connectivity, that is modifying Wi-Fi to go long distance. And that was our low cost connectivity solution. But right now you don't have to worry, because nowadays you have got cell phone penetration in every village, every house. Even nowadays we have got this optical fiber connectivity to our centers also. But then we have learned the lesson and we know exactly what will be the right solution at this point of time. Building, you can rent a building if you have money. Instruments, we know what are the instruments are the ideal, not more, not less. And instruments are available off the shelf. But what is not available off the shelf is the human resource. Of the human resources, the paramedics, who are the backbone of the center, they can be recruited and trained. Over a period of time, they can be molded, they can be made to own the center. So these are all the things that can be done. But the most important thing is the committed leadership. This commitment has to come from the core of the heart. There's no way we can make somebody committed, especially at the leadership level. Only way we can do is that we can show you the results, which I have already showed you. And this one particular human resource aspect, the committed leadership, if we have, obviously the Vision Center is going to succeed. That's an example what we have seen here. Our leaderships were committed. All of us were skeptical. How can it work? How it will work? Will it work? What will be the issues? How can we solve the problem? But we had a committed leadership who are and still were still and will help us in getting a Vision Center established and running well. So these are the challenges, and obviously there will be some small challenges for each different center, depending on the location and all these things. I'm sure if there is a commitment, there is a will, and there is a strong conviction that I'll make the center work, it will work. That's what we have seen last 15, 16 years. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for sharing a more practical and and tangible aspects of running the vision centers. Your knowledge, the things that you have shared from the field level is very relevant, especially to many of us and many of the participants, we hope. Moving on from here, now we welcome Mr. Mohammed Gaud, a senior faculty of LICO, who has been part of the strategic and operational team of Aravind's Vision Center network. So he had a crucial role in replicating this model in parts of India and Bangladesh as well. And we request him to share Aravind's input on what makes a good vision center.
Good evening, everyone, and I'm going to present the primary eye care through IT-enabled vision centers. This presentation focuses on the key components that makes a vision center effective, efficient, and reach its goal of ensuring eye care for everyone. In this presentation, we are going to see what are the key operational components that contributes to the successful running of a vision center. This covers criteria to consider the locations, functioning of vision centers, service delivery at vision centers, support systems to run VCs effectively, training of human resources, and technology for patient care and running vision centers. Location for vision center. As a goal, a location which is 50 kilometers away from the hospital to be chosen in the initial stage of setting up VCs, so that the referral management, on-site visit, support and close monitoring in the initial days are possible. Prefer locations where there is no other eye care provider. Locate VCs in town panchayats or at block headquarters so that there will be provisions for the rural people to access these locations. Base town or village with a population of at least 10,000 and covering 50,000 to 60,000 population in 10 kilometer radius would be an appropriate choice. While choosing sites, prefer the ground floor of the building along with the basic amenities, for example, closets, so that it is easy for the old age people to access. Internet connectivity is a mandate to nowadays for teleconsultation, sharing of records, reports, and attending meetings with the base hospital. As the location is identified, the demographic details will be collected, which includes schools, physicians, grassroots organizations, primary health centers run by government, and medical shops. All these details were used to build awareness and conduct specific programs. While the initial campaign done for the inauguration, the ongoing demand generation will be through word of mouth to the satisfied patients, diabetic screening, school eye health programs, and also to conduct health education programs in the uncovered areas. From our experience, human resources are backbones for the vision centers. The quality of the vision technician, beside the qualification to examine patients, includes interest to work with the community they live, following the organizational values while staying away from the hospital, and a willingness to learn. A work experience in the base hospital will also ensure this and also helps in maintaining good relationship with the various support departments who helps in operations of the vision centers. VCs by principle should be designed to fully available to the community and hence to be operated on all working days of a week. This helps patients understand its permanency to access the services as per their convenience and also increase the footfalls. While deciding on equipments, it facilitates the comprehensive eye examination and should be of good quality, requiring minimum maintenance as the VCs are not able to afford downtime and are far from the base hospital. VC should act as an extension of the base hospital, providing the same quality of service, but limiting to the primary eye care, providing first aid, eyeglasses delivered, prescriptions for eye problems, and reference with guidance for surgery. The patient flow here you see is registration by vision center coordinator when a patient enters the vision center, and refraction and comprehensive eye examination done by the vision technician. If the patient is a diabetic or 40 and above age group, then they will be undergoing a fundus examination followed by the documentation in the EMR. Further to this, the patient will undergo teleconsultation with the base hospital ophthalmologist, and they follow the prescriptions to get an eyeglass. At completing the service loop, it is important to keep the services affordable to the local community so that there won't be any barrier. Keeping the review visits free of cost for an episode helps the patient to come for follow-up visits. Providing service locally helps in uptake, solving the problem of the patient, reduces opportunity cost to the patient. Doing so, at least 85% of the patients treated at vision centers. This solves problems locally, saves communities' economy, increase the trust, and further the demand. Counseling the patient to undergo surgeries, follow-up of patients referring to the base hospital, ensuring compliance is important to complete the service loop. The patient in rural areas deserves all the rights to get the first quality care that is provided in the city, and denying that will be an injustice to them. Hence, exploring and using affordable technology that enhances the quality of care is a timely requirement. While this is an ongoing process, some of them that we found to be more beneficial to the patient and the organization are deploying electronic medical records, which ensure documentation and available for future reference. It also helps the vision center to follow up on chronic eye conditions and keep the environment green. Teleconsultation ensures ophthalmologist interaction with the patient, and it increases the trust and quality. Fundus imaging helps in early diagnosis of chronic conditions and prevent blindness, helps the patient stay productive to the society. I'm sharing the average workload of a vision center based on the recent data 2019-20. Aravind Vision Center's average is 30 OPD per day, with the lowest of 15 OP per day. When it comes to cataract surgery, at least one or two patients advised per day, and overall in a year, they have performed 310 surgeries per vision center. When it comes to opticals, 3 to 4 eyeglasses were delivered for correcting refractive errors in a day, which comes to 85% uptake, and in a year it counts to 1,160 eyeglasses per vision center. Similarly, 50 to 60% of the outpatients may need a medicine prescription to correct minor ailments, and 7% of the patients who visit vision center need base hospital referral for further examination. When it comes to sustainability, the major investments were through internal support or external funding. The operational expenditure will be made through reaching more people, increasing the uptake of services, which includes eyeglasses, cataract surgery. The model become financially viable by the end of 2 years for its operations. What a VC expect from a base hospital? It needs a coach or a guardian who is available full-time to support on demand generation, track the vision centers on day-to-day basis, and respond to the referrals from the vision center to provide feedback on the quality of care given at vision center, patient-centered care, performance, and also to ensure the coverage from vision centers. Managing human resources, which includes providing leaves, alternative postings, continuous training for the vision center staff, and also handling local issues. When it comes to supplies, it's very important support that is given by the base hospital to ensure the adequate amount of supplies available in the vision center and periodic replenishment to be done as and when required. Maintenance of equipments is an important support from the base hospital, and managing infrastructure in terms of painting, cleaning, and also payment of tariffs like monthly rent, electricity, and then internet connectivity should be done from the base hospital, and the burden should be away from vision center. In addition to this, ongoing continuous medical education should be done in coordination with the base hospital. To summarize the mindset for providing comprehensive eye care should be there. The HR should be oriented for the purpose and adequate training. Continuous efforts to be made to complete the service loop for the patients who visit vision center, and by overcoming the challenges, adopting the appropriate technology that supports patient care as and when it required, and then continuous monitoring and improvement. All should be done with the good leadership drive. Aravind internally scaled to 80 locations over a period of 15 years to reach a population of 6.9 million. And while developing its own vision center, Aravind parallelly shared its experience and handhold several states of India and Bangladesh to set up their vision centers. Thank you. Now, let us hear from Dr. Ghulam Mustafa, Director, National Eye Care, Bangladesh, who is instrumental to set up vision centers for the government of Bangladesh.
Dear friends, I am Dr. Ghulam Mustafa, Director, National Institute of Ophthalmology, Bangladesh, which is the apex institute of ophthalmology in Bangladesh. As you know, Bangladesh is one of the densely populated countries in South Asia with 170 million population. Eye care services are provided by government and NGO, but still the reach is inadequate. In 2017, with the support of Aravind, National Eye Care envisioned telemedicine-supported community vision center as a solution to deliver comprehensive eye care services to the rural population. They helped us in defining the scope of primary eye care, ideas for setting up vision centers, putting in place support systems, developing curriculum for training, etc. Aravind helped us to establish the vision centers. Their regular interaction with the team and on-site support helped us to make it possible. We now have scaled up to 50 centers and were able to reach 12 million population through them. We are in the process of setting up 40 more to ensure eye care for another 10 million. I sincerely appreciate LIKU and Aravind Eye Care System's guidance and support in making primary eye care to the rural population of Bangladesh. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Mohammed Gaud and Dr. Ghulam Mustafa. So we are in the final segment of this webinar. So before hearing to the last talk of this webinar, so we request Mr. Tulsiraj sir to share a small information. Sir, we made you co-host, sir, so you can also share. And
okay. I'm literally going to take I'll just take 1 minute. I'm just trying figuring out how to do the sharing. Just give me a minute. Share screen. Yeah. Okay, I just wanted to take literally a minute to state that what really matters is not setting up the vision centers. I think that is largely financial wherewithal. You know, if you have the funds, you can rent the place, hire the people, and put in the technology, street lamp, IT, whatever. But I think what really matters is about making these vision centers really work. You know, what Ms. Narayan also talked about in his inaugural introductory talk. You know, so how do we put in, not only put in good clinical protocols, but how do we make sure they are adhered to? Now, how do we make sure that a patient who enters the vision center ultimately has the problem resolved? Now, either within the vision center itself or by going to the base hospital, how do we track all this stuff? And most importantly, how do we make the staff in the vision center, you know, who are kind of out of our line of sight technically because they're all remotely working. Now, how do we make them highly motivated and to be really part of the hospital team, you know, and then not only perpetuate the hospital's name, but also make sure that the people they serve feel really satisfied and wanting to repeatedly come and then also make others come to the vision center. So this particular initiative that we are now going to talk about is really about that. And I think Suresh will lay out the details of that. Thank you. Suresh, on to you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So we, as I said before, we are in the final segment of this webinar. I request Mr. Suresh Kumar, the senior faculty of LICO, to share LICO's program on how to benefit partner hospitals to establish vision centers and provide primary eye care. So over to Suresh, sir.
Morning to all. Before I go into my presentation, I would like to repeat few points shared by all the previous speakers. Mr. Nagarajan sir shared how Vision Center may help the organization to reach its purpose. Mr. Tulsidas sir stressed upon how Vision Center can help us to achieve the universal eye health. Dr. Datta shared his live example of how it is benefiting the base hospital, which we call as an hub. Finally, Mr. Gaut laid down all the key components on how to make Vision Center a viable unit, creating a win-win situation for the community and the providers. All the four speakers stressed upon two points that is very much necessary for the success of these Vision Centers. The first one is the commitment and the involvement from the leadership. And the second one, these vision centers can be a viable model if it is run well. In the past, LICO had supported Government of Tripura, Chhattisgarh, and Tamil Nadu within India and in Bangladesh collectively. LICO has supported in establishing close to 180 vision centers. In the recent times, we started receiving requests from INGOs and eye hospitals for a support in establishing vision center. So we thought it's a good time to structure this 16-year experience as one of LICO's offering. LEAP Vision Center Collaborative is an attempt toward this, sharing the technical know-how of establishing and efficiently managing vision center. This proposed online collaborative on establishing and strengthening vision center is a 12-month virtual program starting from next month. This collaborative is designed to guide the willing eye hospitals in establishing new vision centers and at the same time increase the efficiency of these established vision centers or the existing ones. The first learning session of this particular collaborative begins in the second week of October. The following two slides are the key ingredients of this program. The eye hospitals, those who enroll in the program, will get the following benefits. The team will be able to establish and efficiently run vision centers following proven evidence-based approaches that are replicable and financially viable. Since vision centers are designed to offer comprehensive care and refer those who require intervention, invariably there will be a substantial increase in the base hospital footfalls for cataract surgeries and specialty services. Each participating hospital will be able to move towards universal eye health in their respective vision center area. With the right guidance and effective running of vision centers, these units can become financially viable model down the line. As many of you may understood, that type of effort and the support system required at the base hospital, that is a hub, to make the vision center a viable model. The team attending this program will be able to establish a system to train the local staff on the competencies required for a vision technician. LICO will be happy to share the online learning management system, Aro Siksha, with all the participants. Deploy IT and telemedicines to improve the clinical diagnosis, quality of care provided, and also to take care of the day-to-day operations of the vision centers. LICO will be happy to provide our cloud-based vision center management software at a marginal price. The team will also be able to strengthen their base hospital support system, like the supply chain management, continuous education for the paramedics and optometrists, and a daily or a regular monitoring system. So, what is the commitment that we make from LICO? Even though this is a virtual program, LICO is geared to provide one-to-one personalized support for each enrolled hospital for a period of 1 year. Apart from the three learning sessions, we'll be connecting with all the partners on a weekly mode to understand the progress and guide them to overcome the challenges encountered during the implementation. If required, LICO will be happy to facilitate the discussion with the eye hospital's management to strengthen or create an internal buy-in for this approach of primary eye care through vision centers. Based on our experience, our team will guide the partners in setting up vision centers, considering all the required parameters like population access. Less footfalls in the vision centers is one of the major challenges for many providers. At Aravind, the average footfalls per day ranges from 20 to 30 outpatients per center. So our team will be able to provide inputs and the strategies on generating demand and strengthening follow-up. LICO will facilitate the discussion with your respective clinical team in developing, validating, and implementing protocols for comprehensive eye care delivery at vision centers. As mentioned in the previous slide, if required, LICO will be happy to assess the staff skills and support the partners to build their vision technician competencies. Now coming to this, who can enroll or attend this program? This collaborative will benefit who wants to set up a vision center and also those who wants to enhance the efficiency of their already existing vision centers. So the eye hospital having a strong desire and also has a required resources like the establishment cost or the funding support to establish IT-enabled vision center by the end of this year. The providers, those who want to improve the efficiency of their existing vision center through adopting comprehensive care along with IT and telemedicine technology. Since this is a team and collaborative effort, we recommend at least 3 members at various levels should participate in this program and be available for the next 12 months. The ideal team compositions are a representative from the senior management. As we know, leadership buy-in and involvement is the foremost important factor for the success of this program. The second one is an ophthalmologist. Since VC needs to be managed remotely, it is utmost necessary for a continuous effort to ensure the similarities in the clinical care provided and it's defined as required. Hence, an ophthalmologist in charge for vision center operations needs to be part of this program. If you don't have one currently, kindly assign the responsibility to one of your passionate doctors. The final participant recommended is an optometrist or the vision technician who will be posted in the vision center so that he or she is on board from day one. Since this is a virtual program, it is fine with LICO. The participating hospitals are willing to train and engage more people in this program. Finally, the success of the program depends not on participation or learning, but how it is translated to action. Hence, we request the interested hospitals to identify these champions and empower them to bring about the change in the way primary care is delivered. Thank you for your patience listening. We are happy to answer your queries or questions. If you require further details, please write to us, either to me or my colleague, Mr. Syed Ali. Followed by this webinar, you will be receiving a mail on the details of this program. Thank you for the opportunity and thank you very much for all.
Thank you, Suresh, sir, for sharing the details of the program. It was very clear. So we are in the last section of this webinar, the Q&A section. So we have some questions in the chat box as well as in the YouTube. So we'll take some time and we'll take few questions from everyone. First question that I would like to share is from Elizabeth Kurian, madam. And this is about the outreach. So is there a scope for resuming outreach in a short period of time? So I request Tulsiraj sir to answer this question.
It is still quite uncertain, largely because of two reasons. Now, one is the regulatory permission and things like that. Because I think both the federal people have to give the green signal and the state governments also have to agree. And then finally, the district collectors have to also agree. Now, so we can recognize the uncertainties involved in outreach happening. So we have launched a different initiative to see how we can work with community groups to have some kind of a referral system or some kind of small screening events to find patients. So it looks like, this is one uncertainty. And the other uncertainty is also the patients showing up for these camps. No, again, in the context of both the COVID and also the outcome of this COVID, which has definitely created a massive economic impact on the poorer people. So I think, all of these things, I think in the short run is making outreach a question mark. And regardless of this, we strongly feel that we need to move ahead with the vision center kind of an approach. Now, even though Aravind does more than 3,000 outreach camps, for the last 4 or 5 years, the number of patients seen in vision centers is far more than what we see in the outreach. Now, so I think there is that decision to be made as well.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So the next, this question, we would like Nagarajan sir to respond. Sir, we have made you as co-host, sir, so you can talk. So this is from Mr. Kuldeep Singh. So what is the most important phase for a vision center and why? So is it planning or establishing or running? So or any other? So which is the most important phase in a vision center?
I think all the talkers said is the leadership's commitment that I will serve the community which is in need. The moment that is there, you figure out what are the things which needed to be done to fulfill that need. So, as I told in my talk also, getting that mindset of making the community as community as a whole, as an inclusive potential client providers or patient providers, and then the referral operational details, which recruiting people, equipping it, locating it, etc., which have been. So I think what Suresh described in his thing, making the hospital not look upon it as an expenditure or as a standalone unit or as a means of just harnessing cataract patients. If they can think that this is an extension into the community of my hospital to deal with all eye care conditions, the base hospital itself will grow because the community will throw up needs, which if the base hospital in the current situation is not able to meet it, it will add on those skills to fulfill those things like diabetic retinopathy, glaucoma, other conditions, etc. Because one is to identify and refer. Second is most important is to close the loop. Tulsi said in his number 2 point, I was that to ensure that diagnosis to caregiving. So it's very well. First thing is, I think, the mindset that I am dealing with a community in need and I'll around my hospital and I'll do whatever I can to provide.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. The next question, there are a couple of questions asked by Mr. Ravi Ranganathan. I'll start with this question. So he's asking about the telemedicine service in Vision Center. Is there such a model promoted by LICO without teleconsultation for VC and the base hospital? So he is asking this question because some of the secondary hospitals may have one ophthalmologist and they may not have the capacity to teleconsultation, and patients might not be very, very satisfied with vision technician service. So is there any model without teleconsultation between VC and base hospital? I request Mr. Mohammed Gaud to answer this question.
So one is the delegate. So I just repeat the question.
The question is, like, some secondary hospitals may have one ophthalmologist and they may not have teleconsultation facility. And patients also may not be feeling satisfied with only a vision technician doing the service. So is there any model promoted by LICO without teleconsultation between VC and base hospital?
So at this point, the straight answer is no, but there is a scope of doing this. Practically, if there is a collaboration with the higher level hospital, you can always connect that vision center to higher level hospital for teleconsultation. For example, there's another secondary or tertiary hospital that is available. You can always link with that particular hospital for teleconsultation. But there are some basic essentials that need to be available with the hospital to start a vision center. First, the hospital should be self-sustainable for its own operations, having a short training to kind of a short training for training its own technicians. So with that, then they can move forward. So one is the basic thing is the hospital has to be self-sustained for its own operation, having adequate manpower in place, and then they can move towards the next level to provide care at vision center.
Syed, I'll quickly supplement Gaut.
Yes, sir.
I think this whole notion of having vision centers will augment patient volume. So fundamentally, the resources will have to be augmented. So if you're having only one ophthalmologist, I think you should be thinking about having the second or the third ophthalmologist, because this whole idea is about working in the community to augment the demand and the reach of the program. So that is one fundamental reality they'll have to check, because, and if they choose not to augment, then that's their decision. The second is that I think to provide quality, you need to have this kind of a linkage. Now, previously, it could not be done. Like when Aravind started, there was no broadband available. But we had made that as a non-negotiable on the quality front, which is why we struggled for almost 4 years. Now, before we set up our own network, which today would be unthinkable. So I think I think you need to make a few things as non-negotiable for the vision centers to succeed. And that is where the leadership comes in. So quality should not be compromised just because you're putting there a technician. That is not right from the patient's point of view. So I would really would request the doctor to reconsider, and we can have a one-on-one discussion if needed.
Oh, okay, sir. Thank you. Next question I'm posting to Datta sir. So this question is from the YouTube. This is on how the compliance to referral to the base hospital of a patient is being tracked, and how we ensure that that service or care loop is closed.
So what we basically do is that a patient who is being referred from a vision center is given a referral letter from the vision center. And basically these patients are referred because the doctor who is giving consultation at the base hospital has asked for this referral to be made, either for further investigation or intervention. It can be a corneal ulcer, it can be a cataract or a glaucoma or something like that. To ensure that these referred patients are not made to wait or we make sure that they feel good. They feel that once they are referred from the vision center, they are given adequate attention and preference. These patients are fast-tracked. There's a particular receptionist and a particular sister who is supposed to take care of any vision center referral. So once we see the patient being referred, we fast track them, we mark them as vision center, we mark them as priority, and they're taken into wherever we need to take, do whatever is necessary, and then we give them adequate attention. We also check the number of vision center referrals in the vision center and the registered. Each vision center tracks their patients, in the sense the number of vision center referrals they check every day and end of the month. And we also check how many have come, that is how many of them have come and registered. If there is a gap, we try to analyze. So we have in Theni, one doctor is in charge of two centers. So we do make a visit once in a month to each center. And we go and track and see what is the gap between the referral and the acceptance. And if it is not acceptable, then we go back and see what happened to the patient. The vision center staffs are known to those, they know those patients, they are from the local community. So they usually, if it is in very important disease, they call back the patient to see why the patient hasn't come. Sometimes it happens that they come without the referral letter sometimes. But then we can always track back that the patient has actually been referred, and then we do the correction. I hope it answers the question. If not, please put it again.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. So there is one question from Mr. Sabitra Kundu. This is regarding the presentation Mr. Gauth made, whether the data shown is post-COVID or pre-COVID scenario.
So the data that is being shared with you is 2019-20, April to March data. But to answer on the post-COVID scenario, this is actually vision centers were actually picking up fast compared to the base hospital. So I will give you a today's example that the Madurai vision centers capacity is close to 1,000 patients. Like Madurai is connected to 32 locations and each potentially see 30 patients. No, and today we are almost filling that capacity. Like so far, I think when the data is, whatever that updated data I have today, as of now is around 701 patients already we have seen. So compared to the base hospital, vision centers are actually picking up. And the major reason is quick access. And then they are getting whatever patients are getting the treatment, whatever they are supposed to get in the vision center itself.
Can I put a word, please?
Yes, sir, please.
A very interesting thing is that in the hospital post-COVID, after the lockdown ended and the transportation started, we are seeing around 200 and odd patients, 250 to 40. Seven vision centers together, we are seeing more than 200. So it looks like, you know, vision centers are doing better than the hospital.
Okay, so thank you, sir. Thank you. And we will have one last question and then we will wind up this webinar. And this question I'm posting to Tulsiraj, sir. What is the most critical indicator to understand if a particular VC is successful or not in the first year of operation?
So in the first year of operation, I think we should look for growth. I would say fairly rapid growth in the first few months of the establishment of the Vision Center. And that is critical for us to gauge the public acceptance, you know, of that intervention. So if not, we will need to get on the ground to do whatever is remedial to be done. I think gauging that, I think the footfalls are a good indicator of patient trust on the center. And of course, operationally, one has to also monitor a fair bit of things in terms of center being open, the supply chain being there, you know, the protocols being followed, and all of that is possible remotely today, you know, thanks to things like electronic medical record, you know, thanks to the IT and the telemedicine that we can put in. And they're not expensive now. I mean, they all sound very fancy, but they're not expensive. I think these are the things in the first year. I think we need to essentially monitor two things. One is, are the processes working as they should? Now, because good process results in good output. The second thing is, can we somehow gauge the patient trust? And for that, footfall becomes a good indicator.
Oh, okay, sir. So thank you. So there are quite a few questions which we'll definitely answer via email.
There's one hand by Ms. Nagarajan. I think he wants to say something.
Yes, sir. Yeah, please unmute and say, sir.
Yeah. What I would like to suggest to the participants of this webinar is, this webinar is not to offer solutions, because even you will not be prepared as to what all are your problems. Assuming that you are running vision centers and intent to run vision centers, you won't be able to visualize. This webinar is to show how Aravind has managed their system and what is the outcome. And second, what are the steps involved in reaching that type of volume and in serving the community, and mainly coverage of the people in need, dominatory responsive of the board. And all this needs a number of things to be done in your organization, starting from the mindset. So this webinar is about letting you know that there is a collaborative which will handhold and on one-to-one basis to take your hospital forward in the path of serving the community very well and thereby bringing in growth to your hospital and the range of services you are delivering. That is the purpose of this, and view it that way. And personally, I would, I'm not promoting the course, but I would like that Vision Center as a model. Somebody asked about outreach camp, they will be there. And as I said, that outreach camp would be events. The switching, like we switched from base hospital to surgical camps to screening camps, I think the next logical move is to our Vision Center so that there is continuous coverage around the year to the community, and a holistic way of serving the community for eye care can be set through this. And this course may help you in establishing.
Thank you. Thank you, Rajan sir. Thank you so much. And so we take this opportunity to thank all the speakers for their talks and also for responding to the questions. So about the program that Mr. Suresh sir was sharing, so we will be sending you an email to all the participants regarding this LEAP collaborative. So secondly, about this webinar, the video will be available through a link, which we will share it with everyone later. So thank you, everyone. Thanks for joining and thanks for your participation. So have a great evening. Thank you so much.
Thank you.